Hello everyone. Thank you for joining this talk. We are Team T5. Today, our topic is Operation Clairvoyance, how APT groups spy on the media industry. I'm Yue-Tien Chen. Now, I work at Team T5 as a threat intelligence researcher. My research focuses on the APT threat in the East Asia region.
Hi, I'm Zih-Cing Liao, also known as DuckLL. Now I work at Team T5 as a senior threat intelligence researcher. I have been invited by international conferences such as Black Hat, HITB, HICON, and CodeBlue. Also, I'm a core member of UCCU Hacker. So, this is our agenda. First, we will briefly overview the APT attacks targeting media all over the world. Secondly, we will introduce Operation Clairvoyance, APT attacks targeting media in Taiwan. Thirdly, we will share a real-world case from initial access to post-exploit. And finally, in conclusion, we will give some key takeaways and mitigation. I'm going to make an overview of APT attacks targeting media. So why do APT spy on media? We can identify three main motivations: information collection, political relationship, and information operation. The first and most obvious reason is information collection. Media are excellent sources for collecting unique information. If an APT group compromises a media organization, it can quickly get a lot of valuable information. Secondly, media organizations often have complex political relationships. Besides obtaining political news, media is also a good resource for social engineering attacks. Actors can target politicians through their contact channel. The third motivation is information operation. Fake news is a significant challenge in the information explosion era. Most people still tend to believe news from credible media. If an APT group compromises a media organization and spread false information, this may control public opinion, sow discord, and make politics unstable. Okay, so now we know the motivation. Let's look at why media is vulnerable to such attacks. The main reason we summarize as follows. Emails. Media usually have many source lines, including university professors, public figures, and politicians. They also receive hundreds of emails every day. Therefore, email phishing is a common attack vector for APT groups targeting media organizations. Social media. Nowadays, media need to manage social media on multi-platforms such as Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Sharing account among multiple people increasing the risk of compromise. Moreover, different platforms may share the same account and password, and the impact of an attack will be very large. Complex web service. Compared to the government and technology industries, the media usually has more web service. In addition to provide service for different users, they also need to quickly develop a new website for events. These numerous websites are difficult to manage and secure. They will be a target of attacks, increasing the risk of compromise. Outdated hardware and software. The media is an industry with a long history. and the most hardware and software have been used for a long time. All the hardware and software may not have been updated and is vulnerable to attacks. The data backup is usually not given enough importance. And the final is lack of information security personnel. Media company usually lack dedicated information security personnel, and IT personnel often double as security staff. Employee may not receive security training, leaving the organization more vulnerable to attacks. Okay, media attacks by APT group can be seen everywhere, such as Taiwan, Australia, and the United States. In recent years, there has been some research showing APT groups targeting media industry. In 2022, Proofpoint published a study that covered APT group from four countries, including China, North Korea, Turkey, and Iran. These attacks involve phishing and malicious documents to attack journalists and media organizations. According to our telemetry data, we have observed that the target of APT attacks are closely related to their political stances. Yeah. Taking CloudDragon as an example, it is a North Korean APT group, also known as Kintsugi. They have target countries such as South Korea, Japan, and the United States. They send phishing email disguised as interview requests to scholars, journalists, or NGO organizations. For more information about CloudDragon, you can refer to our research published at CodeBlue last year. Moving on our main topic, Operation Clairvoyance, APT attacks targeting media in Taiwan. Several factors make Taiwan an attractive target of APT group. Here are some key points. Geopolitics. Taiwan has a complex relationship with China. After the Ukraine-Russian war last year, the geopolitical issue has been deepened. Elections. Taiwan has democratic election almost every 2 years. Putin is almost constantly in an election cycle. Information plays a serious role in election, and APT groups attempt to influence election or political events. Final, semiconductor. Taiwan is a major player in the semiconductor industry. Tension between Taiwan and China has risen after the United States imposed semiconductor sanctions on China. Last year, the visit of Nancy Pelosi, the US House Speaker, to Taiwan was a highly significant event. China strongly condemned this event, even conducted military exercise everywhere in response. During the visit, multiple cyber attacks occurred in Taiwan, including convenience store and train station. Many electronic billboards are compromised and filled with aggressive messages. Our investigation found a suspicious signature left behind, which could be a case of hacktivism. A TV news media was also compromised. Their YouTube channel was hacked, and the news video was replaced with an image declaring Taiwan is part of China. Clairvoyance, in Chinese, 千里眼, is an ancient Chinese deity with the ability to see things from thousands of miles away. We surmise that the purpose of Chinese APT attacks on Taiwanese media is to check the activity in Taiwan. Therefore, we name this operation Clairvoyance. We created a timeline of APT attacks on Taiwanese media and the important political events. The color means different APT groups, and the letter means different media victims. First, we have found that APT attacks tend to occur around times of political events, such as elections or inaugurations. Second, Amoeba is the biggest player in the media playground. Amoeba have launched attacks against Taiwanese media since the middle of 2020. We believe that Amoeba will continue their attacks in the future. We also found two malware, which abuse cloud service Dropbox as its C2 server. Public cloud service is a common way for sharing file with media. The network traffic can be disguised as a normal activity and difficult to detect. In the following section, we will introduce the TTPS used by each APT group. Amoeba is a notorious Chinese APT group, which also known as Winty and APT41. Their malicious footprint have reached almost the whole world, especially Northeast Asian countries such as Japan, South Korea, and Taiwan. Amoeba keep launching new intrusion against various industries such as media, government, and telecom. Here are the loader and backdoor we found. We will introduce how this malware works in Taiwanese media cases. The first is Funny Switch and Funny DL. Amoeba explore the pre-nightmare vulnerability to drop Funny Switch in the target machine. Funny Switch will decode a self-modifying loader. The loader will decode the backdoor FunnyDL and run it in memory. FunnyDL will load its configuration with base64 and AES decryption. Finally, FunnyDL execute commands in the JS modules. FunnyDL is packaged by ConfuseX for obfuscation. There are many options in the configuration of FunnyDL, including password, work time, and the C2 information. The next malware is ChainLoader, also named as Steal Vector. It uses FunnyDL hijacking to be automatically loaded by the Windows Server session event. After execution, ChainLoader will patch some Windows API to bypass ETW for anti-detection. It will read a payload, which is embedded in a certificate of a valid PE file, and decode the payload with CHA-CHA20. After decoding, ChainLoader will inject the payload into Zih-Cing DLL. In the media cases, we found that ChainLoader was used to load backdoor called network. Network hook NSI API to scan the list of active connection and hide its connection. It abused Cloudflare Worker as a proxy for anti-tracking. Next is Keyplug. Keyplug has the ability to use multi-protocol, including HTTPS, TCP, UDP, and WebSocket. The new version of Keyplug adds a new protocol QIC, which is HTTP3. Amoeba likes to develop new protocol for their malware, such as KCP or QIC. But HTTPS is still the most commonly used protocol in most cases. The final one is Shadow Play Ray. From the PDB stream, we surmise that it may be have developed since 2019. Its support function including file operation and command execution. It also creates a registry named NVSure for persistent. The traffic data will be compressed by zlib algorithm. Okay, let's Yue-Tien introduce the next part.
Next, we will talk about Huapi, which is also known as Plead and Black Tag. It targets in the East Asia region with a focus on Taiwan and Japan. Based on our telemetry data, Huapi's top three target industries are government, information technology, and telecom. Huapi uses Bifrost, dbgprint, and tscookie as their backdoors. Bifrost is a full-featured backdoor used by Huapi. The important strings are all encrypted with the modified RC4 function. In this picture, Bifrost will first decrypt the RC4 key and then decrypt the mutex name. After the mutex name is used, it will encrypt the mutex name back to prevent from remaining plaintext strings in memory. Bifrost also checks the process name, such as TCP view, ISOR, and some other processes for anti-analysis. Bifrost contains four backdoor capabilities, including command execution, file manipulation, process management, persistence, and self-delete. Based on the WHOIS information, we found a group of typo-squatting domains related to Huapi. We surmise that Huapi mimicked the domain of some industries, including media, e-commerce, and information technology. The next actor is Gosser. Gosser is a Chinese APT group, which is also known as APT23, Pirate Panda, and Keyboy. Its target regions are East Asia and Southeast Asia. Gosser have focused on transportation, government, and financial institution. In recent year, we found that media have come to their target scope. Gosser use BXShell reflective digit and smiley command as their backdoors. JPGRUN is a loader used by Gosser. It finds the payload in a JPG file by comparing with a specific string and decrypts the payload with byte operations. BXShell is the backdoor that will be loaded by JPGRUN. It is a variant of QLOSD shell, and it was found in the middle of 2021. The name BXShell comes from the banner string, which contains BX6.1. Gosser also used the open source quasi-red. They develop their own loader with DES algorithm. The DES key is provided as an argument during runtime. Similar to Huapi, we also found a group of typo squatting domains which had been used by Gosser. Gosser imitated the domain of some industries, including media, financial institution, transportation, e-commerce, and social media. The next group is Slime 25, which is known as APT 24. In our observation, it mainly focuses on Taiwan. The target industries include media, information technology, education, and government. Slime 25 uses drop socks and lucky task as their backdoors. DropSocks is a backdoor which abuses Dropbox service as the command and control server. It uses a modified RC4 algorithm for file encryption. The modified RC4 algorithm contains a mode variable which decides whether to use XOR or addition operations. DropSocks functions include command execution and file operation. Once executed, DropSocks will create a dedicated folder for the victim on Dropbox. There are 5 subfolders in each victim folder. The purpose of these folders is shown in this table. Finally, we make a control flow graph for DropSocks. In this graph, DropSocks will first connect to Dropbox with the token and create a victim folder. Actors then deliver commands through Dropbox to control the victim. Next, we will introduce Slime 50. It targets in Taiwanese media and government. Slime 50 uses DropCloud as their backdoor. DropCloud is also a backdoor that abuses Dropbox service as the command and control server. From the locale and the country information of the Dropbox token, we believe that Slime 50 is a Chinese actor. From the PDB string, we can see that DropCloud is named as Cloud Server by the developers. Since DropCloud created folders for each victim, we found 13 victims on the Dropbox, including 3 Taiwanese media and 1 government entity. Here is the configuration of DropCloud, including AES key, zip password, and registry pass to store the Dropbox token. The function table of DropCloud is shown in this page. It supports directory listing, information collection, screenshot, file management, and command execution. This is the control flow of DropCloud. It first stores the Dropbox token in the registry. Then it connects to Dropbox and uploads victim information. Finally, actors send commands through Dropbox to control the victim. The next actor is Slime 51. It focuses on Taiwan and India. Slime 51 TTPs contain phishing, Python reverse shell, and Golem-based ICMP reverse shell. This file is a phishing attempt disguised as a PDF file, using a long file name related to a lure theme. It is actually an executable with a double extension .pdf.exe. Once the victim clicks on the executable, it will secretly drop a Python environment folder and a Python script file. The script file is a Python reverse shell, which connects back to the C2 server and executes Python commands. Actors hosted a fake URL shortening website on the C2 server. In our observation, not only Python reverse shell, another Golem-based ICMP reverse shell also connect back to the same VPS in the other Taiwanese media case. Next, we will step into the case study section. At the end of 2022, we found a hacker's node in the Taiwanese media case. Here is the actor's name, Yan Hai, in the node. And we also found some simplified Chinese words in this node, which implies that the actor may come from China. Moreover, we discovered the C2 is located in Hong Kong. From the above information in the node, we confirmed that this attack was from a Chinese actor, Yan Hai. Yan Hai first exploited the SQL vulnerability on the web server with SQL map. From the node, we found several tools that had been used for credential dumping and lateral movement. For example, there was a credential dumping tool named FeiFeiLove. It is a custom version of MimiLove compiled at December 4th, 2022. MimiLove is one of the components of MimiCat that only works on Windows 2000. The second one is NailReGeorge. Yan Hai used it as an HTTP terminal to access the intranet. The third one is InPacket. It appears that Yan Hai utilized a combination of NailReGeorge and proxy chains to execute commands within the intranet. Yan Hai tried to use InPacket secret dump to extract all local credentials for lateral movement. After credential dumping, Yan Hai used WMI hacker to access other remote machines with the credentials and execute commands such as who am I and task list. Next, Yan Hai used DNSCAT to establish a DNS terminal. This DNS terminal was used for the CobalStrike backdoor connection. At the end of the case study, we created this attack path diagram. Yan Hai first exploited the SQL vulnerability. Then Yan Hai used some credential dumping skills and lateral movement tools to access the target machine. In the end, Yan Hai controlled the target with CobalStrike through the DNS terminal. This is the end of our case study part. Let's recap our presentation today. We have already known the motivations behind APT attacks on the media industry and the common issues that media companies face. Numerous news and studies have shown that APT attacks on the media industry have been increasing and expanding. The APT attacks on the media industry is a serious problem that may significantly impact the reputation of media companies and may even threaten civil society and the freedom of speech. Finally, we have introduced the APT groups that we have observed and the malware they use. This malware utilizes new techniques such as embedding payloads in certificates, abusing CDN services, and using cloud services as C2 servers. Media companies need to take more approaches to protect their systems and data. So here, we provide some mitigation. One, strengthening employee cybersecurity education. Providing regular trainings to employees can help them understand the potential threat and how to recognize them. Additionally, it is important to establish clear policies for handling sensitive data and to ensure that all employees understand and follow them. 2, implementing robust security controls. Media companies should implement strong access controls and authentication mechanisms to prevent any unauthorized access to the system and data. They should also have a formal incident response plan to quickly identify and respond to security events. 3, updating and patching software vulnerabilities. Keeping all software up to date and patched can help prevent attackers from exploiting known vulnerabilities. Media companies should have a formal patch management process in place to ensure that all software is regularly updated. 4, regularly conducting vulnerability scans and testing. Conducting regular vulnerability scans and penetration testing can help identify weaknesses in a media company's system and infrastructure. Based on the result of this test, companies can prioritize their mitigation plans and ensure that their security controls are effective. This has been our presentation today. May you have any questions, please contact us via email. Thank you.